This episode is sponsored by Magellan TV. Check out their documentary streaming service to learn even more about history. They have the largest collection out there. Their platform has many high-profile videos and documentaries. We highly recommend that you check out Last Secrets of the Third Reich, Hitler's Henchmen. In this series, learn about the history behind Hitler's power, the money, the generals, and his henchmen. In this episode about his henchmen, learn about Hitler's security chief and right-hand man, Heinrich Himmler. With questions answered like why did Himmler secretly order an extensive research project about witches? Magellan TV is a unique streaming platform focused entirely on bringing historical content not found anywhere else on the web. With over 3,000 documentaries, movies, and series, some available in 4K high def, there's something new for every history lover, from early wars to space exploration. They add new content weekly, so you'll never run out of stuff to watch. Magellan TV is offering a special promotion to our viewers. Click the link in the description to try Magellan TV free for a month. And for all of you who have already signed up, check out The Last Secrets of the Third Reich. You won't be disappointed. Operation Valkyrie, the plot to kill Hitler. July 20th, 1944, World War II. Nazi Germany, the courtyard of the High Command building in Berlin. It was early in the morning of July 21st, 1944, and in a courtyard lit by the headlights of an army truck, a 36-year-old colonel was placed before a firing squad to be executed for high treason. Just before he was shot, he cried out defiantly, "Long live our sacred Germany!" So who was this man? His name was Klaus von Stauffenberg, and apart from being an officer in the German army, he was also a war hero, having been awarded the Iron Cross First Class. He was also of noble blood, holding the grand title of Count of Stauffenberg, his family being one of the oldest and most distinguished aristocratic Catholic families in southern Germany. At the beginning of the war, Stauffenberg took part in the Polish, French, Russian, and North African campaigns. He was also the man who nearly assassinated Adolf Hitler. Hitler had survived several assassination attempts prior to this, but this was to be the very last. Stauffenberg's views on Hitler were conflicting. On one hand, he thought he was a good military leader and was impressed by the Führer's grasp of military strategy. And he also thought he could save Germany from the corrupting dangers of communism. But he had serious misgivings about his social policies, which went against his strong Catholic, Christian, and political beliefs. Stauffenberg thought that World War II was an unnecessary war, feeling the conflict could and should have been avoided. This view was quickly reinforced as the war unfolded. He was first approached about joining the German resistance as early as 1940, but he declined out of loyalty to the oath he took to obey the office of the Führer that Adolf Hitler held. So at this stage, he felt honor-bound to not get involved with the resistance. But he became further disillusioned with what he saw when he took part in the invasion of Russia in 1941, and was particularly disgusted by the SS's violent treatment of the Jewish population. By 1942, he was meeting regularly with opponents of Hitler and coming around to the idea that Hitler's removal was the only way to save Germany. Stauffenberg was sent to Tunisia to join the Africa Corps to take part in the North African campaign. In April 1943, his unit was strafed by an RAF fighter bomber, and he was severely injured, costing him an eye, his right hand, two fingers on his left hand, and damage to his legs. He spent 3 months in a hospital in Germany recovering from his wounds. Once recovered, he could no longer carry out combat duties, so Stauffenberg was assigned to the office of General Friedrich Olbricht in Berlin. Olbricht was the chief of the General Army Office. Among the many things that his office had worked on, Olbricht was to develop the contingency plan, Operation Valkyrie. This was to be used in case of internal uprising or unrest, which was becoming a possibility as Germany was losing the war. Ingeniously, the German resistance realized they could use this plan to mobilize the reserve army to suppress the Nazi government as the conspirators who were seizing control for themselves. For the plan to work, Hitler had to be dead, and this would allow for Operation Valkyrie to be activated and have his inner circle falsely arrested, framing them to look as if they were the heads of a fictitious coup attempt. Then the true conspirators would form a government more acceptable to the Allies, which they then hoped could negotiate a reasonable peace with them. Stauffenberg was crucial for this plan to work, as his duties in his new position included him attending regular meetings with Hitler and his high command. So, a plan was formulated with Stauffenberg and his growing band of fellow conspirators, that he would have a bomb with a 10-minute timer hidden in his briefcase among his papers. They planned not only to kill Hitler, but his two closest and powerful trusted commanders at the same time, Reichsmarschall Hermann Göring and Reichsfuhrer Heinrich Himmler. But this proved impractical, so on July 20, 1944, they put their plan into action. Stauffenberg attended a conference at Hitler's command headquarters called the Wolf's Lair Complex in East Prussia. The original plan for the conference was that it was to be held in a secure underground concrete bunker, but at the last minute, perhaps because of the extreme heat of that summer day, it was decided to hold the day's meetings in a more spacious, above-ground and well-ventilated conference room. Around 20 people attended, including Hitler. Stauffenberg had already set the fuse when he entered the conference room. He then placed the briefcase under the giant oak conference table that everyone was crowded around, as Hitler was pointing to various maps. Then a prearranged phone call gave Stauffenberg the excuse that he needed to leave the room straight away. Shortly afterwards, at 12:42, the bomb exploded, completely wrecking the conference room, blowing out its walls, causing the roof to collapse, and starting several small fires. The meeting stenographer was killed instantly. Three officers died a few days later from their injuries. Many others were also injured. Unknown to Stauffenberg and his co-conspirators, Hitler had survived the blast, though his right arm had been badly injured. It was also said his trousers had been blown off by the force of the explosion, but in reality they were torn to shreds. Stauffenberg, believing Hitler was dead, had immediately driven away from the Wolf's Lair and took a plane back to Berlin, ordering Operation Valkyrie into effect. Units of the German Reserve Army were mobilized and took control of radio stations, telephone centers, and key government buildings. At this time, there were conflicting reports on Hitler's status after the explosion. Then the Reserve Army, also believing Hitler was dead, made arrests of the leading members of the framed Nazi government, thinking they were putting down a coup when in fact they were unwittingly aiding one. Major Otto Ernst Riemer was ordered to arrest Minister of Propaganda Joseph Goebbels. However, the truth came out when Goebbels handed Riemer the telephone and he heard Hitler's voice on the other end. Realizing he had been taking orders from mutineers, Riemer was now ordered to crush the plot by Hitler. The conspirators' plan was brilliantly simple, but quickly fell apart when it became apparent Hitler was still alive and the truth was out. All of those involved were quickly rounded up, including Stauffenberg, who was arrested after a short shootout where he was wounded in the shoulder. Colonel General Friedrich Fromm, who had been a quiet supporter of the coup, betrayed them once it had failed. Stauffenberg and three other of the officers involved, Quirnheim, Ulbricht, and Werner von Haften, were hastily tried in a court-martial and taken to the courtyard of the Bendler Block where they were shot. This was against the orders by Hitler to arrest the conspirators alive, most likely to hide Fromm's involvement in the coup. Few of the conspirators evaded capture and many chose suicide rather than face torture and humiliation at the hands of the Gestapo, the much-feared secret police. So after rushed mock trials that were ironically called the People's Court and sham court-martials, it's estimated nearly 5,000 Germans were executed for their direct or indirect involvement in the plot. They were executed by various means: hanging, guillotining, firing squad, and even strangulation. Stauffenberg's own brother was one of those slowly strangled to death in a Berlin prison in August. Since the war, streets, schools, and buildings have been named after Stauffenberg in recognition of the sacrifice he had made to rid Germany of the tyrant that was Hitler and the Nazis.